So thank you so much for sticking around for our closing roundtable. In this roundtable, we're going to discuss race and the sustainable city. Discourse on urban sustainability tends to refer to things like energy efficiency, climate change, land use, green space, and the like. And while those constructs and issues are certainly critical for thinking about what urban sustainability should look like, very little of the analysis seems to include racial and ethnic inequalities and how race and ethnicity ought to figure in creating livable cities. So we have assembled a panel of four. Dr. Janice Johnson-Diaz will be our moderator, and she has three discussants who will be fielding questions from her, which is always a tricky proposition because I know her. So it's not going to be presentations as we've done with the other panel, so it's sort of along the lines of a Sunday news morning news program, although maybe not as contentious, but that could be fun too, so you know. And so she's going to be posing the questions, and then they'll be answering them, and we'll, I'm sure, have a lively discussion, and then, of course, we'll open it up to the audience for more discussion as well. So I will turn it over to Dr. Johnson-Diaz.
Hello, everyone. I'm not even going to get up because it doesn't even make any sense, really. So
you can't hear me?
They mic'd me so that I can, okay, great. Right? So it is. You should be cautious about asking me to come to a conference with a lot of PhDs. So I play a faculty at John Jay College of Criminal Justice, and I run an organization for women and girls called the Grassroots Community Foundation. And I am honored to be here and honored to be asked by Dr. Kwate to be a part of this, because she figured by now you'll be tired. You'd be worn down and you'd be ready for just about anything. So you see, we had a musical interlude and much like a morning show, go into commercial break. And so today, I am excited to have these three panelists to ask them ridiculously hard questions that many of you are thinking about asking, but because you're polite, you're not gonna ask. So I'm not as polite, so I will ask them all the hard questions. But before I get to that, you always want to welcome people into your house, and you want to ask them to tell you a little bit about who they are. And I will begin by asking them to just briefly tell us who they are and describe for us their disciplinary perspectives and their interest in how they think race and ethnicity matters or factor into a sustainable city.
Begin.
Should I go first?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm Andrew K. Sandoval-Strauss. I'm a historian in the University of New Mexico, and this year I'm at the Princeton Mellon Initiative in Architecture, Urbanism, and the Humanities. And my interest is primarily in Latinos and the city. Right? We have a pretty deep historical understanding of how race worked in the city, especially with respect to white folks and black folks, and with good reason. That was the basic racial polarity for the industrialized and much of the rest of the country for a long time. But I think we need to expand that somewhat, because we find ourselves in a nation in which of the 25 biggest cities, 13 have a quarter or more of their population are Latino, another 8 are one-third or more, and 3 cities are actually majority Latino, and those cities in English are Los Angeles, El Paso, and San Antonio. So you have here a pretty big new phenomenon on the urban landscape, and so what I've been trying to do is figure out, well, how does that change the way we see things. So essentially I've looked at just to get a sort of a deep core, if you will, of empirical information, to look closely at one neighborhood in Chicago, one neighborhood in Dallas. Both are primarily Mexican neighborhoods, pretty heavily immigrant neighborhoods, and to try to zoom out from there and say, okay, well, can we see the origins of the mass Latino urbanism of the early 21st century starting to emerge in the 1960s and 1970s as people begin to immigrate, initially from Puerto Rico, then Mexico, and then much of the rest of Latin America? Is that a good length for the opening?
It's the beginning. It's okay. A really nice, it's a soft beginning. So we're going to go with Hassan.
Well, thank you very much. My name is Hassan Kwame Jeffries. I'm an associate professor in the Department of History at The Ohio State University, where I teach and research on African-American history generally, but specifically on the civil rights and black power movements. I focus in on sort of contemporary African-American experience with social movements and the ways in which sort of African-Americans have created change, gone about creating change for civil rights and human rights, what I call freedom rights, over the decades. My first book was on the Lowndes County Freedom Organization, which was the original Black Panther Party in rural Alabama. And my current book project is looking at New York City over the last 50 years through the experiences of African Americans, working class African Americans, in the Ebbets Field apartments, which is a decidedly working class housing development, the first Mitchell Lama housing development for those who are familiar with New York. But really looking at the ways in which sort of the civil rights struggle has continued, but not by looking at activists per se. For those who look at social movements and do social history, and I am very much one who has fallen into this category, we tend to look at folk on the margins, or the extremes, if you will. Those who are extremely marginalized, and those who have been extremely active. My first book looked at Stokely Carmichael and SNCC, for example. And so this latest project, and my interest now, is very much looking at the people in the middle, and the ways in which those who never get involved in social movements per se, who never stand in front of a camera, but who are affected and impacted and help shape the policies that we have been talking about today, experience life and this environment going forward.
Well, thank you. Welcome.
So I am Saida Lindsay Flores, and I am a professor here at Rutgers in Sociology and Latino and Caribbean Studies. I am trained as a sociologist / public policy / urban planning person, which I'd like to think that I bring those kind of different disciplines into my work. And I am specifically interested in the built environment and housing, built environment and in neighborhoods. And how that enacts race and class inequality in particular, and gender as well, inequalities. I worked on a book, I published a book on gated communities in Puerto Rico, and looking at kind of like the two sides of fencing, and not only as they protect or enforce security or a sense of safety for privileged communities, but also how they have kind of like the other side, how what they do to low-income communities, and also how there are multiple types of gates. There are gates also in public housing and low-income communities, and kind of the divergent mechanisms that they are, the gate, the gilded gate versus the quote-unquote poor gate. And now I am working, thinking of real estate markets in demographically changing neighborhoods in Brooklyn, and thinking of the ways in which the environment is reproduced. So the built environment is reproduced in ways that render neighborhoods valuable, more valuable as they change demographically. And I am specifically interested in thinking of this concept of sustainability. Typically, it's represented as being about the natural environment, I'm specifically interested in thinking about what it means to approach that term through the built environment, and how it shapes race inequality, both physically and symbolically.
It's like she knew I was going to ask that question. So academics like to use their own jargon, right? So you've already heard built environment, you've heard sustainability, and oftentimes we don't know if we're all speaking the same language. So actually, I'm going to ask you to extend your answer a little bit and define for us what is a sustainable city, and what's the role of health or well-being in that?
Yeah, so you know, as I thought about this panel, I thought of Berta Cáceres, which is the slain Honduran activist, which I think exhibits a good example of the way in which sustainability is conceptualized. I'm sorry, I have to refer to my notes because I was in a different conference this morning in a different state, and I took a plane and I had to, you know, get my. So as I thought about it, I thought about her and that conceptualization of sustainability, where local social movements organized to protect indigenous lands and the ways of life threatened by the interests of capital. But what I found interesting about the way Berta Cáceres articulated her fight was that she referred to the forces as practices of patriarchy, sexism, capitalism, and racist. And that really kind of like, you know, that these are racist systems. And that really piqued my interest because typically, and especially in the context of Latin America, race is not something that people readily go to in order to talk about inequality and much less sustainability. But in some ways, the concept of sustainability being, this is gonna be a little bit long, but being circulated there still highlights natural environments, right? And the rightful tenants of indigenous populations. And when we move to the urban context, where you remove things like indigeneity from the equation and rightful kind of like owners of the land, you know, historical legacies and when you remove that and when you remove natural environments and then talk about built environment, what happens to the concept of sustainability? How do we make claims to communities' rights and communities of color's rights over spaces that have been built? So that's the angle I'm interested in.
Okay, so if you could just extend just a little bit to talk about the second part around health and well-being. So where, when we talk about ways of life, we talk about systems, where is the conversation about well-being, especially in that place, thinking about the historical legacy and thinking about ownership?
Okay. Yeah, so what, I mean, I can talk about different sites that might be useful in thinking about this, like residential segregation and concentrated poverty. I'm just gonna mention a few and then talk about one specifically. Housing-based wealth inequality. You know, the wealth disparities by racial group are astonishing in the US, and they go well beyond class disparities. And these are accumulations of historical processes that intersect with the built environment, things like, you know, banking practices, housing discrimination, racial steering. And these continuously bar communities of color, from commonly held sources of wealth for whites, like home ownership. So wealth is important, I think, and lack of wealth results in an inability to define, compete, and highlight the ways of life or practices at the center of sustainability. It makes attacks on the self, right, on insecurity, stress, not being able, it attacks the body through violence, as well as the lack of access to health services. Lack of wealth affects intergenerational mobility and opportunity. It offers no protection against or little protection against displacement. Gentrification being one of the many forms of displacement, but there are many examples. So how do we make these people's lives that have been affected, right, by these policies that challenge the survival, that threaten the survival of these communities and the access to wealth and opportunities that translates into specific health outcomes, right, that are mediated by wealth, by having wealth. And they're mediated not only by, you know, we think of wealth and it's like having cash to go pay for services, but it's more than that. It's having primary care services that are located, you know, at close by. Also violent environments that signal, I'm interested in this thing of perception, so your environment, how it signals kind of destitution and offers also aggressions, mental health aggressions.
Okay, thank you. All right, Hassan, so I would like you to build a little bit on this. In thinking about a sustainable city, could you discuss for us some of the ways in which the historical perspective, right, has brought to bear ideas on sustainable agriculture or how it might play out, especially in these kind of varied racial and ethnic contexts?
Well, I think as so many of the discussants and panelists have mentioned this today, it's important to take a historical perspective. And when we think about what does a sustainable city look like in the American context, for me at least, I think of it as a city in which or a place in which the white residents, their health and well-being isn't sustained by infringing on the civil and human rights of people of color. When we look at the development of America and the metropolitan areas in particular, the major metropolitan areas, we're talking about places that have grown on the backs of black folk, Latinos, Asians, and for the benefit of white folk. And so that is how America has sustained its cities. And so I think it's important that if we start there, then once we look at sort of all the things that we have talked about today, whether that is sort of food access or equity in transportation access, law enforcement, then we have to think about the ways in which these systems and structures operate in terms of what they are doing. So when we think about law enforcement and you say, well, yes, you know, racial profiling is ineffective policing, it doesn't lead to a decrease in crime, well, then why is it there? And then if you take a historical perspective, you say, wait a minute, the whole point of racial profiling is not to stop crime, because they know it's ineffective policing. Stop and frisk does not stop crime. It does something else. And if you put that in this larger historical context, it's only in this sort of modern post-1965 Voting Rights Act, post in this sort of age of colorblind conversation that we alter the purpose of these systems and structures. So if you go back to before the Civil War, taking a long view in the era of slavery, and you say, well, you know, slave patrollers are stopping disproportionate numbers of African Americans. Well, hell, that's what they're supposed to do. That was their charge. And there was a specific purpose for it, to stop either real or perceived crime, right? I mean, it's the same thing that we have today. So I think the first thing is very important, that we sort of get rid of this. We begin from a place of understanding the historical roots of these systems and structures, right? Whether it's, if it's law enforcement, a very convenient example, look, this was not, we're not talking about, then that raises the question of Chicago, right? Is it that somehow the Chicago Police Department is no longer doing what it's supposed to do historically? Well, when has it ever not killed black people? Never. As long as there has been a major metropolitan police force in Chicago, in New York, in Cleveland, they have always killed black folk. So we're talking about creating a sustainable city. You almost have to start from scratch. We talk about transportation, for example, if you're talking about the era of transportation, the history of public transportation in the United States has been one of segregation. So when has it not been that? It may look a little different today in terms of communities that it serves and how we invest our money in public transportation or choose not to invest our money in public transportation, but it has always been segregated in one way, shape, or form. So if you want to create a sustainable city that, for me, involves access, not just the access around public transportation for all people, then we have to almost start from scratch. So it involves when identifying the historical, one, identifying these historical processes, but also being clear that that in looking back and also looking forward, that we have to do away with any notions that we can approach this from a colorblind perspective, because that's just deceiving ourselves. And then connected with that, government has to be involved, because government was involved in the creation from the very beginning. Cities, good or bad, government has always played a role. It's only in our sort of post-Brown minds that we will come to say that there's this thing called de facto segregation, and things just sort of happen as a consequence of the way things happen without anybody really being responsible for the way things happen, which means what? Nothing. It means that people made decisions to create the communities the way they are. And we've always had that. So we have to be involved, except in a positive direction, to undo some of the things that we have done in the past.
All right, so if we're talking about undoing, and Andrew, this is, I think, a question for you. So Dr. Jones this morning talked about two kind of core things. One, she identified that many of us are ahistorical, right? And she also identified for us that a part of recognizing and dealing with the social determinants of equity is that we must acknowledge the historical insult that likely occurred. Now, in your conversation at the beginning, you talked about Latinos. You used the term broadly, and then you talked about what was happening with Mexicans, and you talked about Puerto Ricans, right? So we have essentially what many of us handily use this one term, but we have different historical insults for these two groups broadly, right? We could put Dominicans with the Puerto Ricans. And how does these kind of historical perspective, like the one Hassan is talking about, play into how we can actually begin to undo some of the system? And what do we need to, what do we need to know about these early historical insults that are shaping the way in which we will approach trying to have a healthy city?
Sure. I mean, I think the use of the blanket term Latino is occasionally contested, you know, with good reason, right? The, sort of the history of Mexicans in what becomes the United States is very different from that of, you know, Puerto Ricans. Very different from that of Cubans, very different from that of Cubans. And we have to bear that in mind. At the same time, underlying all three groups and everybody else from Latin America is the sense of having your home taken from you, right? Having the space where you live and you make a community stolen, either through, you know, outright annexation, through occasional invasion by US forces, the deposing of leaders, a constant interference over the course of 100 and something years at least, right? If we are very mild about the time frame. So in a sense, it's about trying to recreate communities that were broken up by the actions, sometimes of US governments, sometimes of US companies, that made it simply impossible for people to live where they lived before, because simply there was no way to make a living. So if you want to talk about in Puerto Rico, right, there's sort of huge numbers of agricultural workers that are forcibly or quasi-forcibly cleared off their land for the interests of US agricultural producers and forcibly urbanized, and then sort of are relocated to the United States. In the case of Mexico, you have large numbers of laborers, and this has less to do directly with the United States, because if you think of the biggest population of Latinos of all of us, two-thirds are Mexicanos or of Mexican origin. There it's the just lack of opportunity, mostly in rural Mexico, to be able to make a living, in part because the government's policy in Mexico, instead of ours, which was starve the cities to feed the suburbs, there it was starve the rural areas to feed the cities. So part of the story here is when Mexicanos, let's say, migrate here, when Puerto Ricanos migrate here, it's because they can't make a living where they are. So if you want to talk about sustainability, it's where can you find remunerative work where it isn't just breaking your back for no meaningful possibility of sustainability, let alone improvement of the next generation and the generation after that. So trying to think in terms of, okay, how do we make sure we don't take active, successful communities of the kind that I sort of describe a lot of these barrios as, you know, they're generally low income. There are a lot of difficulties there, and they're generally abused by law enforcement and immigration enforcement. At the same time, urbanistically, they work very well, right? The level of employment is not terribly bad, especially in Mexican neighborhoods, right? The level of locally serving businesses is actually very strong. And as a result, and here I'll just shift a little bit, if I could, to the health outcomes, you have these sort of repeated moments where public health officials look at this and say, this is not at all what we expected.
The Latino paradox.
Yeah, exactly, right? The Latino paradox that just to give you a couple of quick examples, right? On average, Latinos in the United States, despite being low income, live a little bit longer than non-Hispanic whites. Trying to figure out why that is without resorting to sort of half-baked culturalist explanations.
But it's mostly Mexicans, not the Puerto Ricans. It doesn't work for Puerto Ricans.
In aggregate, right. Okay, so again, they're sort of breaking apart the disaggregating the Latino pan identity is worth doing, right? By the same token, this is true of Latino immigrants, but it's true of immigrants from everywhere in the world, right? Africa, Asia, Middle East. Well, they're very good for America in the sense that we know that anywhere there are immigrants, there is lower crime, right? We don't quite know why, but they've done the sort of the geodata studies to show that where there are immigrants, there's less crime, and in the neighborhoods bordering those with immigrants, there's less crime. So part of the, I think what we have to try to figure out is figure out why that works. And we also know that that effect is degraded a little bit with every subsequent generation. I think my regnant theory here is that they simply get to know law enforcement and trust it less and less. So that sort of initial willingness to cooperate disappears as they see just how indifferent law enforcement often is to their lives. So trying to figure out in a few ways why it seems to be that as good as immigrants are for America, we are not very good for their health. Because
America
gets worse
kills
the
you.
Longer they stay. Right.
Yes, so, yeah. America kills you. Yeah. Now, I want you to just expand a little bit more about that, because we talk a lot about immigration. And in building on this point, one possibility is that Latinos, whether Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, or Dominicans, may just, because of racial segregation in the United States, may just become more black. And they may live closer and closer to black people, then they're subject to all the ill effects of being closer to black people, and therefore become more hyper-surveilled, then deal with the issue of perceived discrimination. Mm-hmm. So we have all of these kinds of things. It's curious to know whether or not that same effect would be in place if we were to think about European immigrants. Do their health degrade at the same kind of sharpness as we see with brown immigrants? Because that question has remained a kind of outstanding, under-investigated question, because we do know immigrants in general, the longer in the U.S., as an immigrant myself, I'm dying every day. I now have allergies. I've never had allergies. My immigrant protection is gone. Mm-hmm. I've been here 25 years. But we do see this decline over time. Mm-hmm. But for brown immigrants, is it possible that the closer association with blackness is also having an effect in terms of the ways in which the systems respond?
This, I think, is the key, and this is sort of where history is very useful, right? One of the big questions in Latino history is who exactly are we? And there, in that respect, it's very important to sort of break down that pan-ethnicity, because in the, after 1848 with the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, the big question was, so what are these people? And under the treaty, the Mexican Americans they were talking about were supposed to have equal rights, so they were, in effect, declared technically Caucasian. And much of the subsequent litigation in Latino America, in order to try to secure equality, was not to prove discrimination and therefore say, well, that's impermissible under the 14th Amendment, but rather to say, well, no, technically we're white and therefore we're entitled to A, B, and C. So you're exactly right when you talk about the de facto as an ex post facto invention. So it's a different legal process. The other important thing, of course, is exactly how are they positioned with respect to black people, right? So if you want to get to my specific research, is trying to figure out that it is true that Latinos live close to black people. It seems as if living close to black people is not the sort of the driving agent, but it's white people's fear of black people and the desire to interpose Latinos. So that in the neighborhood I look at in South Lawndale / Little Village, there was long sort of a supposition that local people there deliberately conspired as white people began to leave South Lawndale to move Mexicans in so that black people from North Lawndale would not actually move in too closely.
So tell me if I'm paraphrasing this right. If the good white people are fearful of black people, then when immigrant brown people come around, then those people suffer. But if they don't fear the black people who are indigenous there, then the brown people who come around, they do okay. I want to get the street corner version of the story.
Jump in here? I think it's important to disentangle this Latino group.
Yes.
Because it's easy, easily kind of like this massive brown thing. Mm. In the service of highlighting race, and how race plays out. So there are very big disparities between light-skinned Latinos and dark-skinned Latinos happening here, which kind of like correlates along ethnic groups, right? Dominicans and Puerto Ricans and Mexicans split up, right?
And then there's the Cubans, but
there's also South Americans, right? I mean, there's a lot big growing South American immigration, and they fare radically different in terms of health outcomes. They are they have access to that thing of becoming white. So I think it's important because that highlights the race, how race is kind of intervening in this process, right, of creating some that are closer to, right, that suffer this, you know, different kinds of discrimination, that end up having certain SES outcomes that, you know, kind of contribute to health outcomes. So you know, we have to kind of outline what the race work
this is done here is. Yeah. Because we all know from the research that's been done is that it isn't a question of what you think your race is.
Yes.
It's the, if you are assigned a race, and if you're assigned black, you are gonna die earlier, faster, quicker, stronger, very Kanye-like, right? But you, if you're assigned white, you will have allocation of greater resources, et cetera. So I do think that this entanglement matters. But in terms of thinking about cities, how do you think the change in kind of dynamic over cities and time, how do these factors kind of come together in how a city should think about organizing itself as you think about the future of cities? So imagine, if you will, if you were talking, as some of you are, lawmakers, people who are designing cities at the highest kind of level, what should they be thinking about? What questions should they be asking, especially in light of, we know, the entanglement of race and ethnicity, and in fact that the demographic of the United States is changing? What are we not asking that we need to be asking now? And I'll begin with you, Hassan.
Well, I think one of the critical questions that we ought to be posing to policymakers is how do we maintain existing neighborhood integrity for communities of color, especially sort of African-American communities, brown communities, out west in particular, in New York and the like, that in which the people there sustained community when they were essentially being abandoned. Many of the neighborhoods that we would identify now as gentrifying, those sort of lower income, high crime neighborhoods, they very much had they had strong community core elements. I mean, even during the worst imaginable times, right, which for me was the late 70s and 80s when I was growing up, you still had, and they were. I mean, yeah, high crime rates, 1990, the highest homicide rate in New York City, so some of that stuff is real. But you still had community. You had institutions, you had businesses. I mean, you had people who were there who were able to sustain. So when we think about sort of what should these cities look like moving into the 21st century? I think we shouldn't just talk about them as cities. We have to talk about them, because people don't just live in a city, they live in neighborhoods, and in these neighborhoods they live in communities. But these cities are also part of regions and metropolitan areas, so we have to be clear about the interconnectedness between all of that. But if we're focusing in on cities and we're focusing in on neighborhoods, we have to think about community and what enables communities to thrive and strive, right? And so one of the great shames, I think, that is occurring when we look at gentrifying neighborhoods in sort of modern America today is that older generation, who really got hit during the foreclosure crisis, the older generation of African-American homeowners who held on to their homes, who did not move in part because they couldn't move, but in part because they were committed to these communities, who are now being forced out. Right, who now have to sell, right? I mean, who now can't afford the taxes anymore. If there's a way, and who have an institutional memory of what made this community strong in the first place. I'm very much a person who believes in sort of intergenerational connections and looking back, right, in order to help sustain and build community going forward. So it's not even a question of just replacing or displacing, because then you're talking about creating something new. I think the way to create something better is to bring in the new. I mean, you know, when you think about the police and black folk aren't anti-police. They're like anti-bad police and bad policing. It's like they don't want bad policing. It's like black folk want cops. They just don't want cops to kill us, right? I mean, that's a real fundamental difference, right? It's like, I don't think that's asking too much. I mean, so it's like, you know, you say, okay, now you're having you know, police and, you know, all these social all these public services that black folk had always wanted, and now they're coming in, but at such a great cost that you only get to enjoy them as long as you get to stay there, and then you're moved out, and then it's gone. And so when we're thinking about a sustainable, one element for me of a sustainable community, or any community, obviously, is the people, but being able to keep people there who contributed so much to maintaining the integrity of the community, I think is critical. And I think we have to do whatever we can, and there's policy elements that can help keep people in place so that they can then contribute to the next generation, the next iteration of their community, of their neighborhood, of their city.
Okay, so I just want to press you on that point, because you use a couple of words interchangeably that are definitely contested, right? So neighborhood and community are two different things. Right, so even if we think in an intergenerational sense, one would argue that previously people had community, now people reside next to each other, which is very different, right? So as you propose this idea of what cities need to do, could you at least extend your conversation to think about the ways in which it's arguable that we've moved from community to now shared residential spaces, and what can those who are designing cities, whether it is in the built environment way or in thinking about the movements of transportation, think about what do cities need? Is it that cities need neighborhood, or do people need residents who are committed to the infrastructure? Like, and where are they interchangeable and where are they different?
Well, I mean, I think you're right. I mean, you can, and New York realtors and real estate developers are very good at sort of creating neighborhood, right? It's like, oh, I lived in this neighborhood until you called it something else, and now I'm in another neighborhood, right? That's neighborhood, right? I mean, that's sort of the politics of real estate. You're absolutely right. But there's also meaning to it, right? So when we think about a neighborhood, you can also think about Bed-Stuy as a neighborhood that has a distinct cultural history. Harlem has a distinct cultural history. When you say Harlem, it connotes certain things. But within that, there are deep institutional roots, deep community roots. Where is the neighborhood bookstore? I mean, where are the churches? I mean, those things create and build community, but they're not everlasting. I mean that much we know. I mean, you know, churches, they come and they go as demographics change, and that's okay. I mean, that's part of the life cycle, if you will. But what's not okay is when that choice to leave or stay is taken from you. When you're sort of forced out because of larger policy, intentional policy decisions that are being made. When opportunities for those elements that make community, that then build neighborhoods, that they can be reinforced. And those are just decisions that we choose to make. I mean, so for so long, the argument had been, when you think about schools in outside, post-Brown, in urban spaces outside of the South, you know, these are neighborhood schools. They just happen to reflect sort of the residential housing patterns without any real conversation about how and why these particular district lines were drawn. How and why, for example, the Dan was pointing out, you know, a stop sign ends here, a curb ends here, a building. All those are conscious political decisions that then disrupt, that create new neighborhoods, that create barriers around old neighborhoods and disrupt community. So I think if we're going forward, I mean, I think you're right. It's important to distinguish between neighborhood and community, because people can talk about, well, we're saving the neighborhood, right? But yeah, but you're destroying the community in the process. So we have to think about those community structures and pillars, and then design and build around that. Like, what will enable an aging generation to still be able to get to their church, right? To still be able to get to sort of a community institution? Does that mean that, you know, we cannot make this two-lane road or four-lane road, right? Those are the types of questions that we need to seriously answer, ask and answer. And if we take seriously that people, ordinary people, have a good sense of what it is that they need in their lives, then we will ask them those questions. And then they will tell us. So we don't have to parachute in as sort of design messiahs saying, oh, I have the answers to everything, right? Like, no, well, we didn't need that. What we needed was a way in Cleveland to get across this highway, right? That's what we needed. Or in Cincinnati, outside Dayton, that's what we needed. We didn't need, you know, we didn't need trees over here. We didn't need a park over here. We needed a walk bridge, right? A pedestrian bridge to get over this highway. So, I mean, that's part of, I think, so what is the answer? In part, or the solution, I think in part, is going to and asking the people who are living there, who have sustained and built community, what do you need and what is your vision for a new community, a sustainable city in the 21st century?
Okay. So Andrew, my question is that, and I'd like to complicate the question for you.
Okay.
Because you think about both rural and urban spaces. So yes. as we think about what questions do we need to ask, yours is complicated by the kind of broader questions of your research, which is immigration, right? Space architecture, as well as these kind of multiple populations that are coming in, and then rural and urban. So what do we need to be asking in order to be able to get to this place?
I'd like, if I could, both to extend on your comments about being respectful of people that are already in a place, and the communities that they create, and the landscapes they create. Also harken back to something Dr. Garrick said a little bit earlier about the ideal for planning, right? So that in the mid-20th century, planners would look at what we today consider a great plan, like a solid urban grid, and say, oh, that's terrible. You gotta make it dendritic, right? So the sort of little cul-de-sacs and whatnot. I think that they might look now at the way that Latino neighborhoods actually work and consider incorporating Spanish city planning, which you could do through, put it this way, communities in place. The thing that I hear more often than anything else, right, in Spanish is like there are no public spaces here, right? Life is lived indoors. We need more, you know, and it's also why when you go to parks in Chicago, right, you're among Spanish speaking and many other immigrants. There's still that sense that they haven't privatized and got to their home theaters and their backyard pools, but still think about in terms of it's normal and natural and pleasurable to be out of doors with your neighbors. So if we can throw in some of the same basic design features of Spanish Town, right, as you mentioned in Jamaica, that all right, there's a plaza, right, and the plaza is where people form a community, not in the abstract but literally, right. That there's a place to go where you see people. And there's an entire, the one that I know best is the sort of the Mexican variant, but an entire public life of courting, of gossiping, of celebrating that takes place in public spaces. So making sure that any city is equipped with those so that the existing life outdoors can continue even more effectively by saying, right, it would be oversimplifying to say just demolish every ninth block and build a plaza, right? Put a fountain in the middle or a kiosco. But it's only half in jest. It would work to create neighborhood gathering places in a way that these new neighborhood residents would see as, well, this is very familiar, of course.
Ah. I want to propose kind of another piece to this. And moving the conversation from community, which I think has some pitfalls as well, in terms of forgetting kind of or pushing aside the structural disinvestments, the structural policies that led to, you know, these techniques of survival, if you will, because of, you know, I mean, everything that was not provided to these urban neighborhoods, that communities kind of like took it upon themselves to create community courts and things like that. So that sort of recycle this idea that really comes from this culture of poverty approach, that these people, it's the other side of the coin, where these people are not, you know, capable of doing things well. The other side of the cone, yes, these people are really capable and they deal with horrible circumstances really well. So let's, you know, go to them and figure out how to, reproduce these dealing with really horrible circumstances, making ends meet. But the importance of also having the conversation of the structural policy investments that need to happen, right? In these spaces that have historically, you know, gone unmet. So, you know, I'm familiar with the kind of like the Latino way of, you know, survival, and there's planning efforts to kind of like recognize that, you know, which is somewhat of a cultural approach to like, this is what these people do to get by and how cute, which at the very extreme can become this, you know, which Arlene Davila talks about this commodifying culture and consumerism of these cultural practices. So just to balance this conversation about community and what these people do, and yes, they do, you know, for survival and to be recognized, but we also have to keep the conversation in the structural side of this and the policy and the investments and the road and the bridge that needs to be built. And, you know, I also think we have to talk about, because sustainability is often like how to respect what's there or what has been created, but also how do we talk about undoing the negative things that have been done, right? Like, and so the conversations about reparations in some sense, right? Like that's a word that means so many things, but how do you kind of redress and give back and invest and reinvest in ways that celebrate, yes, these community practices, but that also recognize that they're structural, right? You know, but we need hospitals and we need services and we need income and we need jobs, you know, how do we continue?
But how do we address Dr. Jones's earlier point, yeah, which says that even if we allocate these things, if you take a neighborhood, yeah, or a city that has not had all these resources and we don't attend to race, right? So we build a bridge, we build a hospital, we build all these things, but we have forgotten that embedded in these systems are these kinds of racial inequity. How are we then? Is it simply the presence of these things? Will that be enough in order for us to have a sustainable city? If we have all the resources, so if we go to, you know.
No.
Oh, good.
No, it's not. It simply isn't. Because what history tells us is that in one shape, in one way or form, it will rear its ugly head. In other words, it is not enough to simply say, okay, we can address this with sort of this colorblind, without consideration to the way in which race has created this problem, that if we just sort of, whatever the solution is we just created, we'll be fine. So the last panel we're talking about police, well, what's the problem? Just tell police to stop behaving badly. No.
Nancy, you don't think that's true?
No. or even a better example, well, you just have to add more black and brown people to the police force, and then that'll solve everything. New York City has one of the most racially and ethnically diverse police forces in the United States. And they ain't doing good, right? Why? Because you haven't addressed the structural problem of the way in which the police force polices and the culture that has developed.
But how do you address it? So Dr. Jones raised this issue. She dropped the mic and she walked away, right? So, but we say, right, so we say that we have to address racism in these things, right? But how?
By no way means that it's a racial, that it's colorblind.
I think
so. Racial right. Intervention to be made that structural. Yeah.
No, so we agree. And I think it was when Hassan was talking about something, I wrote down, sustainability, and the thing that makes racism sustainable, you know, when you were talking about the slave catchers and, you know, that this stuff hasn't changed, all of that is sustainable because of the denial and silence on racism. So the first step in order to make sure that we are addressing racism is to name it. That is the first step. We cannot carry on as if, oh, is it a question whether racism is acting here? We have to name it. It is so foundational in our nation's history. And the thing that makes racism sustainable over all this time is our amnesia, our lack of historical reference, and our sort of reticence to name it when, when you think about all the different manifestations, but it really irks me how there's been no apology for the enslavement of African people and the coerced usury of our labor and all of that. I mean, just little symbolic things where, you know, for some groups, we've made little baby steps toward kind of at least a surface reparation or acknowledgement of an issue, but when you talk about for people of African descent in here, nothing, as if all of that was okay, it was a thing of the past, we're gonna start fresh. No, we've got to name racism. So the way that we start dealing with it is naming it.
Okay. All right, so we have step one. Anybody want to take step two or three?
I'll take a step two real quick. I mean, we think about the mortgage crisis, for example, right? I mean, what was one of the leading factors, compelling the mortgage crisis, the foreclosure crisis, as we talked about earlier today, was the fact that these companies were targeting low income, black and brown, even high income black and brown communities, right? So what do we need to do? If we name that as racist practices, then part of the solution isn't simply a bailout or isn't simply colorblind loan forgiveness. It's saying, going back into these communities, saying, listen, if you were a direct target of racist mortgage practices, lending practices, predatory lending, not just on a commercial, not just on a small sort of paycheck loan label, but on a large mortgage level, then we need to do some real loan forgiveness there, right? I mean, within black communities, for those black folk and brown folk who were targeted, and elderly folk who were targeted specifically for that. We'll do that for all other things. But we need to be clear about if the problem was caused by racism and race was a key element of the cause of the problem, then how can we expect a viable solution to exclude race? We become very sensitive about talking about race and solutions, right? So if we are gonna talk about anything, like if there's any possibility we're gonna talk about race, like, well, we may be able to talk about it as a possible problem way back then, maybe, possibly, but we sure as hell ain't gonna talk about it when it comes to a solution, right? Because suddenly that gardener's worried about their flowers and what they're gonna get there. We have to talk about it at all levels, right? And be clear and explicit without apology for those who are advocates to say, if you're not talking about race, then you're not talking about a real solution.
All right. So that is a very good transition in thinking about what kinds of culturally specific ways of occupying or producing urban spaces do you currently see, either any of you, that you find promising, that does attend to this issue of race, both in the naming and in the addressing?
So I'm doing research in Brooklyn, and one of the things, I mean, just to say another step, there's evidence that there is a penalty for people of color that are homeowners, that they don't get as much money, right, as much equity, just by being them, right, which is race. Just because of race, they don't get the same amount. Their property is not valued as much. And so I've seen how community groups, right, are coming together to help people maintain their house, but also training people in how much they're, and helping people understand the value of their property, which is very grassroots, but they are really mobilizing around this issue of we are not, our property ownership is not valued. We know that we get less money because we're black, and so kind of addressing that at a grassroots level very concretely, which, you know, I think that the government needs to intervene here in some kind of like setting prices across the board with, this is pie in the sky, but yes, but racial solutions typically involve, how do you set market value, economic value in a way that acknowledges unequal, racially based pricing? And it's something that we have to figure out how policy intervenes in this. But at the grassroots, people are mobilizing in this way.
What about you? What do you find promising?
Well, one other way that would sort of work as an effective raise for every Hispano in every city or every brown person, period, is similarly, right? People of color do not receive the same compensation for their labor, whether or not they are, 20 generations back natural born citizens, because the idea in the minds of many employers is, well, these people might be undocumented. I'm not gonna ask them, but I'm just gonna pay them less, right? So if we simply removed that stigma by pointing out that, come on, nobody's, the immigration authorities are not chasing after Irish and Polish people who are here undocumentedly, right? So we should have an immediate amnesty and not a slow path to citizenship, but a very quick one, because that would be both recognizing the inequality of race and looking structurally at, okay, right? I think that there's pretty good survey data from the folks at Princeton saying that, you know, the 1986 La IRCA, right, was great because it creates 3 million people who are able to regularize their status. On the other hand, it also seems to push wages down for all Latinos because of the, you know, they're not going to enforce the employer sanction. There's just going to be sort of an unspoken, well, we'll pay them less and just call it even. So that would be a raise for everybody that is honest about race and tackles the structural problem of being underpaid, right? It's sort of the racially specific end of the $15 minimum wage, to say people need more spending power. A city cannot be sustained with folks working full-time or two or three jobs and unable to afford housing, right? That is not sustainable.
So I can't end any panel. I'm gonna ask you each to make a final statement. So my work is around women and girls. And I know all today we've not really actually just said anything about women and girls, but we do know that in cities, the United States have done a marvelous job of incarcerating black and brown men. So therefore, the people who are often left to run cities, whether it is at the family system or other systems, are women and girls. Where do women and girls configure in both the way you're thinking about race and ethnicity and in sustainable cities? I did say I would ask a hard question.
I can go first on that one if you want me to buy a little bit of time. I think we know from the sociological and anthropological research that, you know, we know that the new circumstances of immigrants begin to challenge their pre-existing notions of what is proper. And throughout a lot of the literature, one of the very first things is that, especially when they come from rural areas, right? Mexicans in particular, like that old style kind of, you know, ranchero masculinity. It's very persistent as an imaginary setting, right? There's the photographer and documentarian Camilo Jose Vergara did some terrific work on Mexican small businesses and the ways that they always have these rural scenes, if you want to talk about the rural, painted on their walls. So they're sort of imagining themselves back onto in el rancho. On the other hand, the wives and daughters are not content to necessarily behave in the way that is expected of them. So there are many ways that struggles within the household over autonomy and earning play out, right? If you look at Robert Courtney Smith's Mexican New York, it's a great example of, you know, different strategies that Mexican women follow to claim greater autonomy. But we have to think very carefully. Well, in a sense, we don't have to think about it since they're already doing it. Right, but this is beginning to disrupt long established patterns of patriarchy, and the outcomes will be pretty interesting, I think.
This isn't just an academic question for me, because I have three daughters, ages 5, ages 3, and 1, so three little girls. And so I do a lot of thinking about their futures. As girls of color, and as eventually women of color, and it is very much not just thinking about what will their future be, because they're going to be great, strong sisters and, you know, change the world. I already know that, right? But what is their life like now, and the forces that are already impacting them. So, you know, when 2 years ago when you had Michael Brown and then Ferguson and then in Ohio we had Tamir Rice and John Crawford down in Dayton, sort of the news in my household is very much sort of a constant. And for my oldest girl, Asha, who's 5 years old now, who was, you know, three and a half, you know, this stuff is in the background. And I'm not really paying attention to how much she's paying attention to these things. But if you remember sort of the loop images of sort of, you know, Ferguson and then, you know, here in New York and Staten Island. My daughter actually asked me one time, she says, at 3 years old, 3.5 years old, am I gonna die like that? At 3.5 years old. I mean, the association that she had already made. I must confess, as a historian of the African American experience, I'm constantly experimenting with my girls. We talk about slavery and all this other stuff. We're kind of all constant conversations. But I wasn't prepared for that, right? And what do you say then? Right? Because I couldn't, in all good conscience, say there's absolutely no chance that you will die like that. Because that's not 100%. And if it's not you, then I don't disassociate us from the community in which I grew up in. Now we don't live in a place that looks anything like the community in which I grew up in, Crown Heights, Brooklyn, New York. That's the truth of it. But I'm trying to make sure that they understand that that's still part of that community that we are a part of. And so the answer for me to your question is I don't really have an answer. It's something the only thing that I can do is talk about it and think about it and talk to my girls about it, talk to older sisters and elders about it. But I know one thing, the one thing that we can't do is not talk about it, even with our youngest ones. Because by age 2, by age 3, they're already recognizing what their possible fate will be in this world. And not just talking about endangered black boys, I'm talking about black girls as well. And then everything that we do with our children now, both as parents, as community folk who are laying hands, we have to realize that it is shaping and molding their future with everything we do. And so the conversations that we have to have them. We cannot not have these conversations. This last thing, I had, I was in class, I was at an African-American MLK celebration and at my daughter's school. And who's in kindergarten, right? So it's like wonderful African-American, Martin Luther King Day celebration, wonderful. Sit next to a very lovely, very kind white mother who has a mixed race child, biracial child, daughter, lovely as well. And she's a lawyer, so very highly educated. She turns to me and says, Hassan, is this your first MLK celebration here at the school? I was like, oh no. Girls have been here 2 years, 3 years. This is my third one. And she said, well, this is my first time. I was like, well, that's odd because your girl has been here three years as well. I said, well, why is it just your first time? She said, well, I didn't want to bring them to the last one. And I said, like, okay, who doesn't go to a MLK celebration, especially when you're the mother of what is ostensibly a black child, right? She said, well, I was afraid of sort of what she would take away. And I'm like, from an MLK celebration? Like, what is going on here? But essentially boiled down to, she said, I wanted to preserve the innocence of my daughter. And I said, listen, there is no preservation, right? As this is racism and white supremacy, to call it, to name it, is a disease. And what you need to do through these conversations is hopefully inoculate your child from this disease. And if you do not, just as you would take them and give them their immunization shots, if you don't sit and have real candid conversations about what's happening in the world and what their future might hold, then you are just exposing them to this disease. And by 5, it may already be too late. You don't know what has already seeped into their consciousness. So I was like, not only better you better be at this MLK celebration, but you need to come back home with me and let me give you some books that you need to sit down and read with this little girl. But it all goes back to naming it and having these real conversations, right? And starting as early as we can.
I don't know if I can follow that up, but I'll say, I mean, I think that's a reminder, right? That these, of the importance of thinking about other dimensions and of intersectionality. I mean, when you posed the question, I thought of Kimberly Crenshaw's questioning the policies we use to address, for example, violence against African Americans and blacks, and she's suggesting, you know, the violence that affects black women is different than the ones that that affects black men. And so, or thinking of Latino immigrants and domestic violence and their reticence to report because of documented status. So thinking of other dimensions the experience of racism that takes hold and that needs to be taken into account in thinking of solutions so that, you know, sustainability can be presented in this kind of like neutral way, right? And when we state, okay, we need to think about it as racist, but we also need to think about the intersectionalities also apparent in that. In my research, invariably, who ends up telling the stories, who I end up talking to are women, right? And what does it mean that they're telling the stories of, for example, of police violence? What things does that highlight that might indicate kind of other approaches or other things we need to tend to, right? That might not be about necessarily confronting a police officer, but the impact of being a parent, right? Or a mother with a child that might face the police violence. So that pushes us in different directions, right? We might think about mental health, stress, and the consequences of that, the health consequences of that. So it's a good reminder that there is more to think about and that there are other dimensions of this than kind of like this blanket racism, groups of color. So thank you for that reminder.
Well, thank you all. I want to, Dr. Jones, because she's in my head, started this morning by she put up a definition of health equity. And she says it is the assurance of the conditions for optimum health for all people. And so in your closing comments, and you all can take it in any order that you wish, leave for us one or two things that you think would create, within the framework of your own work, an assurance of the conditions for optimum health for all people.
Well, I'll begin just say briefly. I think the all people, we have to take the all people aspect of it seriously and involve all people in sort of decision-making processes. Now, that doesn't mean that we hold aloft and idealize, you know, sort of survival strategies and the like, but to take seriously this idea that people, that it's a human right for people to be able to have a say in decision, in the decisions that impact their lives. And so when we're talking about sort of health and well-being, I think it's incumbent upon us as a society, as policy makers, as thinkers, to think about ways and think about policies, a way to construct policies that incorporate and involve. Because if you want to have maximum effect, and I think the public health folk would possibly agree, then having buy-in and involvement from the people that you're trying to reach is critical. There's a long history of distrust, and rightly so, among African Americans and among the black community, among poor folk, for dealing with sort of medical health, public health professionals, and the like. So I think it's even more incumbent to get that full buy-in, that full involvement. And the way to get full buy-in, in part, is through full involvement matched with resources, right? So, policy is paper unless you put money and resources behind it. So whatever the equitable solution is, unless you're willing to invest the money, the resources, the time, and the involvement, the time it takes to involve people in making these decisions, I don't think we'll get the kind of equitable outcomes that we hope to get.
Thank you.
I mean, in an ideal world, if we would simply sever healthcare from citizenship, right? You all remember that you lie moment with the president when somebody sort of, and what they said he was lying about was that these benefits would not be extended to undocumented people, right? And so I think the president, for political reasons, had to delimit it, since it was hard enough, I guess, for him to get through the law he could without saying, oh yeah, this will be for all undocumented people as well. If we could live in a world where we realize that the United States is demographically not sustainable as a viable nation state with all of its attendant social programs without plenty of new Americans, and that the folks that already live here are not making enough new Americans, to say, our future depends on these newcomers. And so to recognize that our fate is entwined with theirs. And again, like, you could just simply do broad legalization and then true universal health care, that'd be great. But even beyond that, more people will come, and then they will go and they will come back. So to begin to say, you know, that this should be in effect a human right, both because it's a part of the basic dignity of the human being, but also partially because it's our self-interest for all of us to be well together. Because if you want to talk about something that is social, right, disease and wellness, that's one of the most social things out there.
Mm. Indeed.
I mean, I'd like to think that research is one of the ways in which to address just opportunity, right, and life chances. And so, you know, in some way, I'd like to think that we're participating in the kind of addressing the problem, and we choose different ways of doing that. In my case, it's research and unearthing the indirect ways in which race and racism informs life chances, and one of them being health. So I'm really interested in how, you know, there are many ways in which race affects health in indirect ways, discrimination and where you live and what you're exposed to. So continuing to uncover, name, trace, measure the indirect paths to of race to health inequality. In my specific area, it's affordable, safe, secure housing, and the ways in which race intervenes in limiting the opportunities in that area, which ultimately, you know, you might measure in health outcomes. I don't necessarily do the race, the health outcomes, but thinking of that as a mechanism that's important to consider. So I'd like to think that research matters, and that we're part of the cohort that names it and identifies it as well, as we move towards solutions.
Well, I want to thank you all. You have survived this roundtable. And I want to end by saying that I know that you know, we've had a long, really engaging day, and a part of, I think, the questions that were raised at the beginning, the comments by Dr. Jones, the comments around transportation and around housing and law enforcement, it leaves us, I think, with a charge that maybe hasn't been stated yet, but the panel really raised for me, is the idea that we need to get into our lexicon the idea that we're talking about systems and systems are intertwined. That it's quite difficult for us, because that's just not the language that we have, is that we have been stuck in a kind of lexicon that doesn't allow us to even imagine that systems are real and we can see them. And if you're as old as I am, you might remember Rowdy Rowdy Piper's film where he had on these glasses that says, "They live." It seems to me that we need those glasses as well to be able to identify, so we can see the lines of the system, which existed before the Matrix, because it is when, as you've heard from today's conversations, there is this idea that all of these systems are so deeply intertwined. And so for many people, they feel like a Leviathan because they're not named, they're not recognized. And so to name something is a first part of it, but what is it that we're naming within these systems? Because they clearly live, and they live in our city spaces. So thank you so much for your time. Thank you, panelists.
Thank you.
That was the best conclusion ever.
Nice dialogue.